بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, welcome back to Shu'ara'una. For those of you joining us for the first time, we are excited to have you on this journey as we go through the rich poetic tradition in Islam. In season one, Alhamdulillah, we had the honor to study some of the themes and poems from the great collection of Allama Iqbal Rahimahullah. Alhamdulillah, I benefited immensely, and I pray and hope to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the audience also benefited. Season one was all in Urdu and Farsi. The poems were Urdu and Farsi. So for the Urdu speaking people and the Desis, they had a field day, Alhamdulillah. And I hope they benefited especially. And I tried my best to translate to the best of my ability and to also explain to the best of my ability. But now we're gonna go into a different language. And for the Urdu speaking people, I'm asking and requesting you to stay on board as we jump into the language of Quran, into the language of the Prophet ﷺ, into the language that we will all be speaking in Jannah, inshallah. And inshallah, the familiar we get with this language, the more we can connect with the Quran, the language of Arabic. And inshallah, we have decided to cover the poetry of one of the greatest poets in the Islamic history, and that was none other than the great Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah.
استحييت تعصيني وتخفي الذنب عن خلقي وبالعصيان تأتيني فكيف أجيب يا ويحي ومن ذا سوف يحميني أسلي النفس بالآمان من حين إلى حين.
Imam Shafi'i رحمه الله's name is familiar to many of us. He was a great jurist, faqih, and one of the four great imams of this ummah. I don't intend to do a detailed bio of his life. Rather, inshallah, we will cover that in our series titled Saviors of Islam. In this episode, I would like to go over some of the aspects of the life of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, so we can have a better understanding of who this man was and appreciate his work and his poetry. To me, the greatest honor was that Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah was from the direct lineage and descendant of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. He was from the direct lineage of the Prophet ﷺ. Muhammad bin Idris bin Abbas bin Uthman bin Shafi' bin Sa'ib bin Ubaid bin Abd bin Yazid bin Hashim bin Abd al-Muttalib bin Abd Manaf. So many of us probably recognize the last two names in this lineage. And who are they? Abd al-Muttalib, Abd Manaf. Abd al-Muttalib is who? He's the grandfather of the Prophet ﷺ. Muhammad ﷺ bin Abdullah bin Abd al-Muttalib. So Imam Shafi'i's lineage connects with the Prophet ﷺ at Abd al-Muttalib bin Abd al-Manaf. And from there, it is the same lineage up to Adnan and up to Adam alayhi salam. Abd al-Muttalib bin Abd al-Manaf bin Qusay bin Kilab bin Murra bin Ka'b bin Lu'ay bin Ghalib bin Fahr bin Malik bin Nadr bin Kinana bin Khuzayma bin Mudrika bin Ilyas bin Mudar bin Nazar bin Ma'ad bin Adnan. Up to here, the lineage of the Prophet ﷺ is preserved, and after that, till Adam al-Islam, there's a difference of opinion. And this was the lineage of Imam Shafi'i as well. So this was his greatest honor. He was born in the great land of Gaza. Subhanallah. He was born in Gaza. He himself, he says, وَإِنِّي لَمُشْتَاقٌ إِلَىٰ أَرْضِ غَزَّةِ لَوْ ظَفِرْتُ بِتُرْبَتِهَا كَحَلْتُ بِهَا مِنْ شِدَّةِ الشَّوْقِ أَعْيُنِي or جَوَانِبِي in another narration. He says, I yearn, later on in his life, he said, I yearn to see the land of Gaza again. And if I ever get there, I will put surma, kuhul, on my eyes with the dirt of Gaza. I'll kiss the dirt. That's how much love he had for that land. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help the people of Gaza and all the Muslims all over the world who are suffering. May Allah give them protection, help, assistance, shelter, food. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. So he was born in Gaza. And when he was 2 years old, his father passed away. So he became a yatim. But he was really, even though in literal sense he was yatim, but how Ali radiallahu anhu says, لَيْسَ الْيَتِيمُ الَّذِي قَدْ مَاتَ وَالِدُهُ إِنَّ الْيَتِيمَ يَتِيمُ الْعِلْمِ وَالْأَدَبِ. He says, an orphan is not the one whose biological father has passed away. Rather, an orphan is the one who has no ilm and neither does he have any adab. That is an orphan. That is an orphan living in this world, even though he may have a biological father living. So Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah's father passed away, was yatim. And at this point, his mother decides to move to Mecca with Imam Shafi'i. so that he could be preserved and he could benefit from the anwarat and the light of Makkatul Mukarramah and Haram and the scholars who were living there. So this worked out perfect, mashallah. When he was 7 years old, he became hafiz. And when he was 10 years old, he memorized the entire collection that Imam Malik rahimahullah known as a Muwatta. He memorized the entire collection at 10. Subhanallah. So some of us may think, you know, he was young, it's easy to memorize when you're young, and when you get older, it takes longer, it becomes more difficult. So as we get older, we start getting discouraged from memorizing Quran or from surahs. Like, oh, it's too hard, it's for kids. I mean, we push our kids when they're young to memorize, which is a good thing. But memory has nothing to do with age. Age is not a factor, it's rather the sins are a factor in making the memory weak or strong. When children are young, they don't sin, so their memory is strong. When we get older, we start sinning, our memory gets weaker. And this itself, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he talks to his teacher, in a poem he narrates, he says, شَكَوْتُ إِلَىٰ وَكِيعٍ أَنْ سُوَ حِفْظِي فَأَوْصَانِي إِلَىٰ تَرْكِ الْمَعَاصِي وَأَرْشَدَنِي أَنَّ الْعِلْمَ نُورٌ مِّنْ إِلَهِ وَنُورُ اللَّهِ لَا يُعْطَى لِعَاصِهِ. He says, I complained to Waqi' ibn Jarrah, who was his teacher, who was also, rahimahullah, was buried in Egypt. He says, I complained to him about my weakness of my memory. Subhanallah, Shafi'i, you have weak memory? Memorize the Quran at 7, memorize the whole Muwatta at 10, what are you complaining about? But he says, I complained to my teacher about the weakness of my memory. So he gave me this recipe. He didn't tell me to do all these drills and word searches and to, you know, elevate your IQ level and get your memory stronger. But he just gave me one simple recipe. He said, فَأَوْصَانِي إِلَىٰ تَرْكِ الْمَعَاصِي. He said, oh Shafi'i, don't sin. Because every time you sin, it weakens your memory. Remember that. So for those students of knowledge who are studying and memorizing hadith, memorizing poems, you know, memorizing it now, it's not just about memorizing, it's about retaining that in your memory, in our memory. And if every time we sin, our memory becomes weaker and weaker and weaker, and what's the point at that point, right? So he says, don't sin because sins make your memory weaker. Why? فَأَرْشَدَنِي أَنَّ الْعِلْمِ نُورٌ مِّنْ إِلَهِ. Because ilm is a nur from Allah. It's a light from Allah. وَنُورُ اللَّهِ لَا يُعْطَى لِعَصِي. And the nur of Allah can never penetrate into a dark heart. It can never penetrate into a heart that's full of sins. So that's why this mention of this memory becomes weaker or stronger has nothing to do with that. So Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he memorized a Muwatta at 10 years old. And at the age of 15, his teacher, Muslim bin Khalid, he says to him, now Shafi'i, you go. You are a mufti of this town. Go give fatwa now. So he was given the authority of giving fatwa. He was a mufti, declared mufti. Not like us nowadays, like we become mufti and we're declared self-declared muftis. No. Subhanallah. He was a mufti at the time where there was great scholars and muhaddithin. And they said, go at 15 years old. And at the age of 17, he himself says, I memorized 10,000 poems of the tribe of Banu Huzail. Banu Huzail were known as the most poetic, eloquent Arabic-speaking tribe of Mecca. And he says, I memorized 10,000 poems from that tribe. And he says, وَلَوْلَا الشِّعْرُ بِالْعُلَمَاءِ يُزْرَى لَكُنْتُ الْيَوْمَ أَشْعَرُ مِنْ لَبِيدِ. He says, if it was not for the fact that poetry and writing and reciting long poems was disregarded by ulama, I today would have been a greater poet than Labid himself. So because of that reason, I did not get involved with long poems. But at the age of 17, I memorized 10,000 poems. So Yunus bin Abdul A'la, he says something interesting. He says, كان الشافعي إذا أخذ في العربية. He said, when Imam Shafi'i would sit down and start talking about nahwa and sarf and the grammar of Arabic, قلت هو بهذا العلم أعلم. There is nobody in the world that has more knowledge about nahwa and sarf and grammar of Arabic than Shafi'i. وإذا تكلم في الشعر وإنشاده. And when he would start talking about poetry and how to put stanzas together and how to make things rhyme, قُلْتُ بِهَذَا الْعِلْمِ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ. There is nobody in the world that has more knowledge about poetry and for the formation of stanzas than Shafi'i himself. And then a few hours later, when he would وَإِنْ تَكَلَّمَ فِي الْفِقْهِ, he starts talking about fiqh and jurisprudence and the ta'wil of the Quran of hadith, I would say, قُلْتُ بِهَذَا الْعِلْمِ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ. There's nobody more knowledgeable about Quran hadith than him. So he was a polymath. He had, subhanAllah, gifted this man with the knowledge of Quran, hadith, Arabic, and poetry. And that's why his poems are very simple, but they're full of wisdom and full of advice. And Imam Shafi rahimahullah, he says it's beautiful. To me, the reason my first connection with Imam Shafi rahimahullah's poetry was when I was a child, I was a kid. And our teachers used to recite some of his poems. And one poem that stuck to me, and I feel like that's so important in this time and age, is one of his poems where he says, نُعِيبُ زَمَانَنَا وَالْعَيْبُ فِينَا وَلَيْسَ فِي زَمَانِنَا عَيْبٌ سِوَانَا وَنَهْجُ ذَا الزَّمَانَ بِغَالِ ذَنْبٍ وَلَوْ نَتَقَ الزَّمَانُ لَنَا هَجَانَا. He says, we complain about the time that we're living in. You know, when we're studying in madrasa, we say, oh yeah, there's so much distractions, and that's why we can't learn, and that's why we have phones now, we have Wi-Fi now, and it becomes more difficult to learn. And now even parents are like, they talk about their kids, that it's, you know, we're living in a time and age where there's iPhones and Wi-Fi, and everything's there, there's so many distractions, and we start blaming the time that we're living in, the era that we're living in. And he says, وَمَا لِزَمَانِنَا عَيْبٌ سِوَانَا. Our era has no fault but the fact that it carries us in it. We are the fault of the era. We have the weaknesses. These people like Imam Shafi'i, they were not people of their era, but rather they made era themselves. They're the ones that made history. They became legends. They set the record straight. And they carved the path and they set the standards of everything. So he says, look, وَمَا لِزَمَانِنَا عَيْبٌ سِوَانَا نَهْجُ ذَا الزَّمَانِ بِغَيْرِ ذَنْبٍ. We complain about the people of this time and the time that we're living in. And he says, وَلَوْ نَتَقَ الزَّمَانُ وَلَنَا لَهَجَانَا. If Allah gave tongue and the ability to speak to the time, it would have cursed us and said, what are you doing? What have you done lately? Don't yell at me and don't call me anything. It's your fault. What have you done? And then he says, فَدُنْيَا نَتَصَنُّعُ وَالتَّرَائِي. He says, our time in this dunya is all about just being artificial and about showing off. وَنَحْنُ بِهِ نُخَادِعُ مَنْ يَرَانَا. And through that, we easily deceive the people who see us. So we easily could be made to be more pious and religious. It's easy. We go to the masjid and see people. We can easily fool people by the way we look. You know, wear this big imama and sit in front of you guys on the camera. And it can seem like this man, mashallah, he's a great alim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. We're nobodies. You know, he's saying this is what happens, that it's easy to do that. And people that see you get confused and get deceived, and they start taking knowledge from you. وَلَيْسَ الذِّئْبُ يَأْكُلُ لَحْمُ ذِئْبٍ. He says, a fox never eats the meat of a fox. وَيَأْكُلُ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضٌ عِيَانًا. And us human beings, we always eat the flesh of each other openly, عِيَانًا, openly, backbiting and slandering each other. And then he says, لَبِسْنَا لِلْخِدَاعِ مُسُوكُ الدَّأْنِ. He says, we wear the cloth of the sheep to deceive people, meaning we put this really nice look on. Our public life is totally different from our private life, right? Our external life is way different from our interior life, right? Internal life. And he says, we put this show on for people, and he says, فَوَيْلُ لِلْمُغِيرِ إِذَا أَتَانَا. He said, I feel bad for the person who comes to ask you a question. I feel bad for the person who gets deceived by that. And so Allah make us among those that we have the true ilm, the true knowledge. And we're not just people who people consider us scholars, and people consider us pious, and people consider us Muslims. Rather, we are considered by Allah as Muslimin, as mu'mineen, as ulama, as talabatul ilm, as the seekers of knowledge. And uhibbu salihina walastu minhum. Myself sitting here today, how can I try to explain and elaborate on the poetry of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, those poems that he recited sometimes in Safar while he's traveling, sometimes in Mecca, sometimes in Medina, sometimes in Iraq, sometimes in Egypt, while he was going through all these different situations in life? Who are we? How could we ever justify explaining the poetry of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah? We can never. We are sinful people. But this responsibility is upon our shoulders, and I feel that it's important that we all benefit from this, his poetry, we all benefit from his work. وَحِبُّ الصَّالِحِينَ وَلَسْتُ مِنْهُمْ. We love those pious people, we love them, they are the crowns of our heads, but we're not from among them. And inshallah, because of our love for them, Allah will unite us under the shade of his arsh on the Day of Judgment, and we'll be united with him in Jannatul Firdaus. So inshallah, I would urge all of us to stay tuned to the season as we cover one poem at a time, one theme at a time, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah in Arabic. And inshallah, we'll, from time to time, we'll go over some of the words. May Allah make it easy for us to act upon whatever was said and benefit from the poetry of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, and benefit from the work that he left for us, and inshallah be a means of inspiration for millions of people to come after us. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.